So, very welcome, everyone. My name is Anders Kral, and I'm a postdoctoral fellow in the Department of Philosophy here at the University of Calgary. And it's my pleasure to introduce to you this evening our two speakers, Professor Douglas Shantz and Professor Hartmut Lehmann. Professor Shantz earned his doctorate at the University of Waterloo in 1987 on Reformation history. During the 90s, he served as professor at Trinity Western University in British Columbia. And since 1999, he holds the chair of Professor of Christian Thought at the University of Calgary. Professor Shantz has published widely on various topics in Western intellectual history, including on major figures like Leibniz, Erasmus, and Johann Arndt. He's also published work on such phenomena as religious conversion. And of course, he's one of North America's foremost experts on German Pietism. The topic of this evening will be Professor Shantz's recent book, An Introduction to German Pietism, from 2013. As someone who doesn't work in the field of German religious history, but in British Enlightenment history, I can assure you that Professor Shantz's book is extremely valuable not only to specialists in the history of German religious thought, but also to everyone interested in the Enlightenment and themes pertaining to the Enlightenment more broadly. Our second speaker this evening is Professor Hartmut Lehmann, who is a distinguished German historian. Professor Lehmann has held many distinguished academic positions. Apart from his professorship at the University of Kiel in Germany, he is also a former guest professor at Harvard University, at Princeton University, and at UCLA. He's also a former director of the Max Planck Institute for History in Germany, and also a former director and founding director of the German Historical Institute in Washington, D.C. Professor Lehmann has published widely on various topics on central figures in Western intellectual history, including Erasmus and Martin Luther and Max Weber, and the phenomena of secularization, to take just a few examples. Professor Lehmann is also an expert on German Pietism, so it is a great pleasure to have him with us this evening. So here's a brief outline of how this evening will unfold. Professor Shantz will begin by talking a bit about his book. After that, Professor Lehmann will offer comments on the book, and this will be followed by an exchange between Professor Shantz and Professor Lehmann, about 15 minutes exchange. And after that, we'll open up for questions from the audience, and we'll try to bring the event to a close around about 9 o'clock. After the session, you'll also have the opportunity to purchase a copy of Professor Shantz's book and to have it signed if you want. So please join me in welcoming Professor Shantz.
Well, good evening. Thank you for coming. It's good to see you out on this Monday evening. And I'm especially grateful to Andy for agreeing to chair this evening. Andy and I met by the elevator just a couple of months ago and discovered we have a lot of common interests. And I'm, of course, especially grateful to have the Lehmanns here this evening, Hartmut Lehmann and Zilke Lehmann. I met them in, I believe, the year 2001, when I was at the Max Planck Institute for History in Göttingen. And so I appreciated your hospitality then, and I'm glad that I can return the hospitality now. We went up the Calgary Tower yesterday, and I had never done that before, so the Lehmanns gave me that opportunity. It was their suggestion. So I am happy to, of course, say a bit about my book. And I framed this evening's panel in terms of presenting Pietism to a North American audience. I, I realize it's not obvious, maybe obvious, that this topic has any relevance whatsoever. Those of us that are in the humanities are constantly being challenged to show the relevance of what we do. Like, why should anybody study religious studies or philosophy? Is it relevant? And it's a perennial question for the humanities, especially in southern Alberta with the oil patch. If you can go from high school to Fort McMurray and make $90,000 a year, why would you spend 4 years getting a BA in philosophy? To get, maybe then go to the oil patch after you. But anyway, that's the broad question. But the more specific question is, why a book on German Pietism in 2013? Why should anybody in North America be interested in such a book? So that's the way I've kind of framed this evening. And in the course of writing this book, the editor actually asked me that question and challenged me to think about that, which I was happy to do. The first question, however, that I want to address is, what is Pietism? What are we talking about? And so I'm going to give you the definition that I have on page 7 of my book. Pietism arose in the late 17th century German Empire among empowered laity and clergy in the prosperous urban settings of Frankfurt and Leipzig. The Pietism movement introduced a new paradigm to traditional German Protestantism, one that encouraged personal renewal and new birth, conventicle gatherings for Bible study and mutual encouragement, social activism and post-millennialism and ecumenical cooperation. Pietism included an eclectic mix of spiritual alchemy, radical Reformation traditions such as Anabaptism, biblical devotion. The legacy of the Pietists includes reforms in caring for the poor and the orphan, new Bible translations, new social networks, experiential literature such as the autobiography and memoir, and worldwide missions. Pietism thrived in German lands in the late 17th and 18th centuries among all social classes, among both Lutherans and Calvinists. So that's the definition that I gave. Now, on this question of relevance, this is the way I frame my justification for the book. Why a book on Pietism? The case needs to be made, especially for a North American audience. Here it is. German Pietism represents a key but forgotten strand of the religious DNA of North American Christianity. Early European settlement on our continent is not just the story of Puritans and immigration from England. Probably the largest group of European migrants to America in the 18th century was German. About 100,000 German-speaking migrants, actually my ancestors are among these migrants from Switzerland in the 18th century. Among the 100,000 German-speaking migrants that arrived in North America during that century were the Pietists, especially radical Pietist dissenting groups. Although comprising less than 10% of German immigrants, the Pietist influence greatly exceeded their numbers, and they often succeeded in proselytizing other German settlers. By 1776, they made up more than a quarter of all German congregations in the New World. These Pietist Christians brought an ethos of hard work and a born-again faith rooted in a well-read, well-marked Bible and a hymnody of Christian experience. Now, how did I come to write this book? I am an historian, and I'd like to go back to when I was 12 years old. I'm not saying it was predestined from the time I was 12, but when I was 12, my parents left the United Church of Canada to become Baptists. And that was a big issue for me, I would say, at the time. And I would say one reason I'm a church historian was my effort even then to make sense of these differences among Christians. Socially minded Christians, born again Christians, that was part of my vocabulary when I was 12. And I think ever since then I've been trying to figure it out. But to focus, so that's how I became a church historian, I think. But what about Pietism? Where did my interest begin there? Now we have to go back to the early 1980s when I was a graduate student in history at the University of Waterloo in Ontario. And at the neighboring university of Wilfrid Laurier, Peter Erb was teaching religion. And he had just translated part of Johann Arndt's True Christianity and put it in that Classics of Western Spirituality series. And he gave me a copy of this book, for which I am grateful. And I would say, of course, this was the favorite reading of many, many German pietists, Johann Arndt, True Christianity. And so that sparked my interest for sure. I did not write my doctorate on Arndt or the pietists, but the interest had been sparked, and I would come back to it later. Now, the beginnings of my book on pietism, we need to go back to 2005, and at a conference, I believe it was in Umeå, Sweden, and a professor by the name of David Eller, who edited a series on pietism and Anabaptism, asked if I would consider writing a book for Johns Hopkins University Press introducing German pietism. There has been very little in English on this topic. There's much less on German pietism in English than there is on the Reformation, on Puritanism, on Methodism, the Mennonites, the Anabaptists. All of those topics have comparatively a huge amount of material in English compared to German pietism, comparatively little. So he asked if I'd consider this, and the rest is history. I had a sabbatical in fall 2009, winter 2010, and began writing the book. And by fall of fall of 2009. By late November 2010, I had a manuscript. And of course, these things take a long time. They went through many revisions after that. But that was the genesis of the book. Now, I want to read a few passages to give you a sense of who these pietists were and make it concrete, give you some specifics. And so I've chosen to read a passage from my book that deals with some pietists who migrated from Germany to Pennsylvania. And these were people who were influenced by men named Beisel and formed a community called the Ephrata Cloister. They're essentially, they became a Protestant monastic group. Early modern German authorities followed a consistent policy of persecution and expulsion of members of radical religious groups who followed their conscience in matters of faith. Hartmut, Lehmann has written about this, essentially apologizing, I guess, for this Protestant mentality of persecution. They were denounced as enemies of the state. It is no surprise that many of these earnest Christians chose the option of migrating to the New World, to North America. Some 3,000 to 5,000 members of radical pietist communities were among the 100,000 Germans and Swiss who emigrated to North America between 1683 and 1800. The most significant numerically were the Moravians and New Baptists. I'm leaving aside the Mennonites now. But among these pietists, the Moravians and New Baptists, or Dunkers as they were known, the German sects kept to themselves, settling in distinct enclaves throughout the Pennsylvania countryside. Representative of these radical pietist migrants is the story of Georg Conrad Beisel and the community he established in Pennsylvania. Historians have a rich collection of sources at their disposal for investigating the life of Beisel and the community at Ephrata. There are two contemporary narrative accounts that offer very different perspectives on Beisel. The Ephrata Chronicle of 1786, edited by Peter Miller, is the key source, but it tends to hagiography. Beisel can do no wrong. Also valuable is the autobiography of Ezekiel Zongmeister, a disgruntled opponent of Beisel. You can imagine how this enriches the story to have his perspective. It was entitled The Life and Conduct of Brother Ezekiel Zongmeister, a longtime resident at Ephrata. Beisel, of course, was an author in his own right. He published devotional writings, hymns, mystical proverbs, poems, letters, and a major work entitled A Dissertation on Man's Fall. Georg Conrad Beisel was born on March 1st, 1691, in Eberbach, in the Palatinate, the 10th child of a baker. His father died before he was born, and his mother died when he was just 8 years old. The family was Reformed, or Calvinist. Conrad grew up in circumstances of poverty and war. While still in his youth, he was apprenticed to a baker and spent time as a journeyman in Mannheim, Strasbourg, and Heidelberg. In the early 18th century, there was intense Pietist activity in and around Heidelberg, with itinerant preachers coming and going. One of these was Matthias Baumann, who was separated from the Reformed Church after a series of visions that he received in June 1701. Other preachers included Johann Georg Rosenbach, Hochmann von Hochenau, and Alexander Mack. These Pietist circles were exposed to the writings of Jakob Boehme and Jane Lead, and students who take my course, they need to learn who these people are. Jakob Boehme and Jane Lead were some of the favorite writers for these Pietists. After studying the Bible and the works of Boehme, Beisel experienced a conversion at a Pietist meeting in 1715. By that time, authorities were harassing and arresting Reformed Pietists out of concern for the growing number who were responding to the Pietist message. In 1718, Beisel was forced to leave Heidelberg. He found refuge with a baker in Dudelsheim who belonged to the community of True Inspiration. In 1720, a couple of years later, Beisel and four friends sailed on the ship Elizabeth and Hannah, arriving in Boston in October of 1720. He made his way to Philadelphia with the hope of joining Johannes Kelpius and the hermit community that Kelpius had started near Germantown called the Woman in the Wilderness. You might have to admire their creativity in the names. Can you imagine the First Baptist Church of the Woman in the Wilderness? We don't have interesting names like that. However, this community had already disbanded, and so Beisel spent the next year in Germantown as an apprentice to the weaver and new Baptist leader, Peter Becker. Becker had immigrated just the year before, along with 20 families of new Baptists. In 1722, Beisel moved to Conestoga, Pennsylvania, newly settled by Swiss and German Mennonites and other groups. For a year, he lived in a cabin on Mill Creek as part of a communal household with some other young men. In November 1724, Peter Becker arrived in Conestoga during a preaching mission through Pennsylvania, through the countryside. In the ensuing revival, Beisel and six others were baptized by Becker. The fledgling Dunker congregation chose Beisel to be its leader, reflecting the love and admiration they felt toward him. He quickly established principles that would guide his future religious life. He observed the Sabbath on Saturday, the seventh day. He upheld celibacy as superior to marriage. His teachings brought conflict with other Dunkers, and in 1725, Beisel and some supporters established a community on the farm of Rudolf Nagle, a former Mennonite whom Beisel had baptized. In December 1728, Beisel reenacted the baptism that they had received from Becker, marking their break from Becker and the Dunkers. So there's that good Protestant tradition of splitting up and creating new communities. In February 1732, Beisel withdrew to a solitary life in a cabin on Caucalico Creek in what is now Lancaster County, Pennsylvania. Soon joined by members of his former church, he established the Ephrata community, or the Ephrata Cloister. Beisel organized the Order of Spiritual Virgins for single women and the Zionitic Brotherhood for single men. Over the next 10 years, the community continued to grow through Beisel's evangelistic efforts. Two of his converts were the sons of Alexander Mack, the leader of the New Baptists. This period saw a building boom with construction of monastic houses for sisters, another one for brothers, another house for families and chapels. At its peak in 1755, the Ephrata community numbered 300 to 400 residents, comprising celibate men and women and some families. Members farmed and built an industrial center with sawmill, paper mill, oil mill, fulling mill, tannery, and weaving enterprises. Beisel died on July 6, 1768, his last years marred by illness and conflicts over his successor and ownership of the cloister's land. When the last nun died in 1813, Ephrata was reorganized as the German Seventh-day Baptist Church. The principles guiding the religious life of Ephrata can be found in Beisel's maxims and his rules of the solitary life. The themes of poverty, humility, and acceptance of adversity are prominent. And these next comments are quotations. In all your doings, carry yourself as poor and as a possessor of nothing in this world. A solitary life, separated from the world and creatures, ought to be your greatest treasure. We can easily forfeit our fortune in this world. Everything which presents itself to you, be it small or great, prosperous or lean, severe or mild, should not cause you to be moved by too great joy or too great sorrow, but rather maintain the balance. In all things, be careful and thoughtful. Dwell only on those things which benefit your salvation. At all times, listen rather than speak, for the ears of the wise are attentive, but the fool's heart is on his tongue. Bicel introduced distinctive rituals and dress to Ephrata. Between 1735 and 1740, he required that celibate members wear common clothing as a symbol of their unity. It consisted of a long white habit with wide sleeves and pointed monk's hood for men, and a similar habit with rounded hood for women. In 1740, Bicel appointed a date when the celibate brothers would read vows of eternal chastity and receive the tonsure, a symbol of betrothal to Christ. On the same day, the sisters read vows and had their hair cut short. Bicel established ascetic rituals that included fasting, reduced sleep, frequent times of prayer. Other practices included baptism of believers by threefold immersion, foot washing, and the love feast. This unusual mystical group had an exceptionally vibrant cultural life. The Ephrata community became famous for their handcrafts, including embroidery, calligraphy, painting, and spinning and weaving. Bicel was an outstanding musician and hymn writer, composing more than 1,000 hymns, of which 441 were printed. The Ephrata cloister established one of the earliest German print shops in the New World in 1745. The shop produced 43 German books, including the entire Martyr's Mirror, the Anabaptist martyrology of 16th century martyrs, at the request of some local Mennonites. The Martyr's Mirror was the largest book published in the American colonies before the Revolution, a folio volume of 1,482 pages in fine calf binding. A long tradition says that 14 of the cloister's brothers worked on it for 3 years, 6 working in the paper mill, 4 as typesetters, and 4 as printers. Peter Miller, prior of the cloister, translated the work from Dutch into German. Bicel directed and coordinated the undertaking. The German edition of the Martyr's Mirror has been called the most precious German book published in the 18th century in the German language in America. W.R. Ward's words capture the unique world that was Ephrata. Quote, "The Ephrata community was an extraordinary center of music and cultural achievement, of spiritual sweetness and practical help to neighbors, of spiritual impulses which issued in revival, of theosophy, alchemy, and magic." So I hope I've whetted your appetite a bit. That last statement, spiritual impulses including theosophy, alchemy, and magic. That's not the most common mix of items that you think of in terms of evangelicalism. And scholars are still trying to get our heads around this. This is the beginnings of evangelicalism and new birth with these kinds of groups. I'd now like to talk about Pietism and, or read about Pietism and women. Because if there's any feature of Pietism that is, I think, a dramatic innovation, it's the increased opportunities for women as compared to the role of women among Catholics and Lutherans and Calvinists. Gender scholars are finding that Pietist networks and conventicles gave women new opportunities. They gained freedom to read and interpret the Bible, to raise their voice as prophets with a message from God. Women found the courage to write of their faith experience in diaries and memoirs and found a ready audience for their writing. Women took leadership roles within households and Pietist gatherings. They pursued theological discussions with men and corresponded with Pietist leaders. Now, this is one of my favorite parts in the whole book. Women as ecstatic prophets. Page 191. In the early 1690s, women prophets and ecstatics were prominent in the separatist conventicles that began to spring up in central Germany, in Erfurt. These are particular cities, Erfurt, Gotha, Quedlinburg, Halberstadt, and Halle. Women themselves did not leave any writings behind due to their lack of education. But there are testimonies from contemporaries, records of church interrogations, theological discussions of these women, polemical denunciations of the women, defenses of the women, and court records, all these different kinds of sources. In December 1691, some letters were exchanged among Pietist associates of these women and published in the book Actual News of Three Enthusiastic Maidens. Also viable are eyewitness reports about their ecstasies, one written by 30-year-old Johann Baptist Crophius. He is known as the Pietist Judas because he converted to Catholicism in 1694. These women prophets had several characteristics in common. They were mainly uneducated and from the lower social class, a circumstance that seemed to confirm their calling as humble instruments of God. They had no natural advantage, their gifts must be divine, of supernatural origin. Their social status was reflected in their message, which contained a condemnation of the powerful and the mighty of this world. Most of these women were unmarried and childless. Unhampered by family cares, they were free to pursue their religious calling. Their role as prophet was sometimes accompanied by bodily signs, such as illness or stigmata. The women received their prophetic revelations in a state of ecstasy, their bodies sometimes frenzied, sometimes completely rigid. During this ecstatic experience, they saw or heard something denied to others. The revelations received by Pietist women contained new insights into the meaning of Scripture, usually interpretations that confirm Pietist teachings on Christ's coming millennial kingdom, the soon-to-dawn millennial kingdom. They were post-millennial, which means that they expected the next item on God's calendar was not the return of Christ, but the millennium. So Christ's return was at least 1,000 years away. The millennium would come first for these people and was about to arrive. The stories of three women prophets can be reconstructed in some detail. Anna Maria Schuchart in Erfurt, Magdalena Elrichs in Quedlinburg, and Agnes Greffner, the wandering prophet. Anna Maria Schuchart has been especially well researched. Little is known of her early life, just that she was born near Frankenhausen and that her father was a bricklayer. She could neither read nor write. She arrived in Erfurt in early 1691 and worked as a maid in the home of the jurist Johann Gottfried Schmaltz, a devoted Pietist and friend of August Hermann Franke, one of the Pietist leaders in Halle. Shortly after her conversion in early November of that year, she had her first ecstatic experience. Prior to this, she had no interest in Christian things. She did not even learn the catechism and disliked listening to sermons. In the vision, God showed her the torment of the damned and the joy of the redeemed. God also showed her which of her neighbors were godly and which would be condemned. She fell into a pleasant sleep and heard God say, "Be of good comfort, my daughter, your sins are forgiven." On December 17, 1691, around 6 p.m., she again fell into ecstasy, and during a half-hour period, she recited more than 200 rhyme verses as God held her in his arms, according to her. Although she normally spoke a Thuringian dialect of German, she recited these verses in High German. She was later unable to remember what she had recited. One observer said that in the verses, she thanked God for converting her and asked God that he might convert the ungodly, preserve the godly, and give her strength to resist the world's temptations. An eyewitness, a smith, reported what he observed during Schuchart's ecstatic experience while visiting in Leipzig. Andy, can I bother you with some water?
Sure.
Thanks. I left my glass on the table back there. So here's an eyewitness report of one of her ecstasies. "When I saw her in ecstasy, she lay down as if dead, completely rigid. After lying like this for a while, she began to move and to speak. In her speaking, she made unusual gestures depending upon what she was speaking about." Thanks. "When she spoke of the downfall of Babel, she stood in an awful, terrifying manner that made my skin shiver. But when she spoke of help from Zion or the hope of better times, I cannot describe the joy that she expressed. It was as if she would burst for joy." Schuchart began to receive visions almost daily, often five times a day. In January 1692, her messages became more harsh. She spoke of God's imminent final judgment. "Make yourself ready. The judgment day is not far off." She condemned Erfurt for its treatment of August Hermann Franke and warned that the city would face God's punishment shortly. God showed her a great pit that held Erfurt clergymen who had opposed the Pietists. She began singing while in ecstasy, sometimes for up to 2 hours. Some witnesses noted that at such times, her voice was much more beautiful than usual. Sometimes she cried out, "That's delicious," later explaining she had eaten heavenly food and had heavenly water to drink. After an illness in February 1692, her ecstasies temporarily ceased. But in a letter of March 11, 1692, an observer wrote that she once again sang some unknown hymns. This is my favorite part right here. In May of that year, some friends encouraged Schuchert to work at home and to be more quiet. They observed that she would rather be with people than stay at home and work, for she is by nature a great talker. One eyewitness said that he had seen Schuchert in her ecstasy grasp the hand of someone standing nearby, pull him to herself, and hold him with both arms so tightly to her body that he could not get free. The person had to remain like this until she released him. What most impressed Crophius from his interactions with Schuchert and Erfurt was her ability to reveal to him the innermost secrets of his heart. She also did this with complete strangers. Okay. Now, the last two chapters of my book, I consider the question of the significance of Pietism. And I suggest that Pietism did play a role in the rise of modern individualism and modern-day evangelicalism. French scholar Michel Godefroy observed that to write the history of Pietism means nothing less and nothing more than to write the history of Protestants in the modern age, meaning the last three centuries. There is an element of truth in this. Pietism initiated a departure from traditional Lutheran Protestantism, introducing a new paradigm that was marked by the experience of renewal and new birth, conventicle gatherings, successful mission to the world, and the reign of Christ on earth. These features of Pietism live on in the evangelical Christianity found in North America today. It is thanks to three books by W.R. Ward that this connection is now being made, at least understood among North Americans, English-speaking people. Ward's three books in the history of early evangelicalism reorient the story away from the North Atlantic to Central Europe to show the largely German roots of evangelical religion. Evangelicalism for him is no longer simply an Anglo-American story, beginning with the conversion of Wesley. Ward gives central place to Johann Arndt, Jakob Böhme, Pierre Poiret, and the Pietists. Stephen Stein has argued that German Pietism deserves a larger place in accounts of American religious history. This adjustment would provide a corrective to the tendency to focus too much on New England and too much on English-speaking immigrants. The story of Pietism in North America provides the historical context for the Great Awakenings and some of the ecstatic phenomena that appear among the converted there. And then, just to wrap up, some hard questions remain about the legacy of German Pietism. Historians have long been divided on this point. For some, the Pietist story represents something valuable and worth preserving. For others, it's a cautionary tale of wrong choices and failed ideals. In this conclusion, I consider what the historical study of Pietism indicates about its cultural and religious legacy and its impact in the world of today. There is a dark side to German Pietism. An honest appraisal must include not only the positive achievements and intentions of the Pietists, but the disruptive and destructive real-life consequences of their beliefs, experiences, and actions. These cannot simply be dismissed, as some would like to do, as aberrations of true Pietism. Rather, they belong to the warp and woof of the movement and are reflective of inherent problems, I suggest, in the Pietist paradigm of conversion and renewal. Pietism began as a Pietism began as a response to the divisive and polemical Protestantism of the 17th century. Yet, the Pietists themselves left a trail of division and conflict. In 1682, the Zollhof Pietists in Frankfurt became a thorn in the side of Philip Jakob Spener with their separatism and refusal to attend church services and sacraments. They divided the Christian world into those who were born again and those who were not. those with living faith and those with nominal faith. There is spiritual elitism, marked Pietism from the beginning, and left its members open to pride, presumption, overconfidence, and dramatic falls from grace. Pietism in Halle is a story of unrelenting interpersonal tension and conflict. By 1695, August Hermann Francke's relationship with his church and the city of Glauca was marked by increasing conflict over decisions he made that antagonized both parishioners and city leaders. He hired Johann Anastasius Freilinghausen, his son-in-law, as his pastoral assistant against the church's wishes. Francke decided on a parcel of land in which to construct the orphanage, despite vehement opposition from the community, from community leaders who wanted to build a city hall in this choice location. Francke's relations with a close colleague in the Halle Foundations, Christian Friedrich Richter, deteriorated until they became embittered and beyond repair. Francke had a falling out with his wife, Anna, over the marriage he arranged for their daughter, Sophia. For some months, Francke and Anna lived apart. Franke's judgmentalism and strict application of church discipline became a source of real concern to Spener. In a letter to Francke, and Spener would be like Franke's spiritual mentor. In a letter to Francke dated July 9, 1692, Spener expressed shock over Franke's strictness in excluding an innkeeper from the Lord's Supper because he had served people on Sundays. On October 27, 1704, 40 of Franke's parishioners sent a petition to the Prussian king complaining that they and some already deceased members had repeatedly been denied the Lord's Supper, in some cases for 8 years. This perfectionist ecclesiology, this perfectionist practice in the church, was an enduring feature of Francke's thought and explains why many of his early associates decided to forsake church appointments and join separatist communities. And I'm going to leave it there and turn things over to my colleague Hartmut Lehmann.
I'm most grateful for this invitation. It's something very special for me to be here. And it's a special privilege also to comment on your book. Let me begin by saying that much has to be applauded. You wrote a wonderful book, and all of those who work on the history of Pietism have to be very grateful to you. Rather modestly, you say there is no equivalent in English. Let me add, there is no equivalent in German either. So I wish that your book would be translated. Your book is well informed. You have included the research of the past few years, and to a surprising degree, one finds the recent research well documented in your book. You have a clear disposition. You have a wonderful ability to present arguments. Your text is supplemented by translation of important sources, and the sources alone make this book very valuable. Also, you have questions which can be used in classroom. So in a way, also an extensive bibliography, in a way, it's a multi-purpose book, also something quite unique. In addition, there are some quite innovative things. You are not only adding up what has been researched by others. For example, your analysis of the four types of radical Pietism can be found nowhere else but in your book. And then, of course, on gender, you just spoke. This is also something very important, that you do include the results of gender studies. So much has to be praised. And my following remarks are not supposed to contradict this statement. Rather, they are meant to open the debate on some of the open questions that still remain. And in fact, you yourself point to some of those questions. For example, just to give one example, you point to the lack of studies on the role of suicide in Pietism, which has not been researched, and that is an important topic also. Now, I want to make five questions I want to raise. The first question concerns chronology. As most Pietism scholars do, you concentrate on Pietism from the late 17th to the late 18th century. In my opinion, and within Pietism scholars, this is a minority position, I have to add. In my opinion, one has to look also much more into 19th and 20th century Pietism and into the continuity which does exist. For example, the extraordinary success of Pietist missions from Basel and other locations, from the Basel missionary house. Also the extraordinary success of Pietist Bible institutes, the most important being the one in Stuttgart, the Stuttgart Bible Institution. In both cases, these were Pietists from southern Germany and Swiss Pietists. And in both cases, they were supported, and this is very interesting, they were supported by an international network of friends with a center in London. So without the London friends, Pietists could not have achieved the missionary work in Basel, nor the Bible production in Stuttgart. And I would like to add at this point that in particular in the decades after the French Revolution, Pietism was vibrant and strong in southern Germany, stronger than two or three decades earlier. In fact, some of the books on earlier Pietism that we rely on today were produced by 19th century southern German Pietists who want to create a genealogy and a legitimation for their own efforts. Therefore, this is my first point. I think it's important to pursue Pietist activities well into the 19th and in some cases also into the 20th century. You do this when you point to evangelicalism, but there were such groups who called themselves Pietists also in that era. My second point is typology. and as I indicated in my remarks just now, and please forgive me as I'm a native of that region, I think you underestimate in your book the strength of Pietism in Württemberg and neighboring regions like northern Switzerland, also in the Palatinate, in Franconia. And the Pietists of that region were different from the Pietists in northern Germany. They were of a very special kind. Let me just point to some of the main characteristics. They were not supported by noble families, but rather by members of the upper, of the educated upper middle class. They strongly opposed absolutist government, and they believed in self-administration and in the representation of people in regional diets. So there was a political difference, let's say, to the Pietism of Franke and Spina and in northern Germany. And with few exceptions, they were not very active in social issues. They hardly created orphanages and similar institutions. Rather, they met in conventicles. They trusted the values of a quietistic lifestyle. They concentrated on spiritual edification. And above all, they strongly believed in the second coming. Now, not the millennial, post-millennial, pre-millennial, but really in the second coming. And their patriarch, Johann Albrecht Bengel, whom you mentioned in connection with the Bible studies and the role of the Bible, their patriarch, Johann Albrecht Bengel, after extensive studies of the biblical text, was sure that Christ's second coming would occur in the year 1836. And this has been a key date for all the Pietists active in 1800, 1810, 1820, that they would make a major effort towards the building of God's kingdom prior to Christ's return in 1836. And last not least, you mentioned that and you gave extensive quotes. Most of the Pietists who emigrated to Pennsylvania in the 18th century came from southern Germany. They were from that region. So it's this variety of Pietism which was infused into the North American religious body. So this is my second point. One should give more weight to these groups. And if one does, Halle and Hartmut with the Moravians no longer appear as strong as they do in your book. And more importantly, a new variety of Pietism is added to the whole picture. And again, linking up with what I said before, in contrast to northern Germany, in southern Germany, there is a continuity of Pietism beyond the end of the 18th century, into the 19th, and in some cases also into the 20th century. Now my third point concerns controversies within Pietism. You mentioned some of the controversies, rightly so, but let me give you some more examples and to show how divisive this whole whole movement was. Quarreling seemed to have been an important matter. What is the truth? I have the better truth. No, I'm no even better than you do. Württemberg, sorry. Württemberg Pietists and Bengel in particular opposed the Moravians and Zinzendorf. And Bengel wrote a whole book in which he listed all the shortcomings of Zinzendorf as being too, as being unreliable, as being too emotional, as being a bad theologian, and on and on and on. And Zinzendorf was effectively banned from Württemberg, and as if he was spreading, almost stories given to him by the devil. He was seen as that bad a person. Also, Halle, that you mentioned, also opposed Hartmut and also opposed Zinzendorf. And for example, they did so in outlying places like the court in Copenhagen. In the court in Copenhagen, there was a real rivalry between who has most influence, now Hartmut or Halle. Halle won in that case. They had the same rivalry in the Baltic countries. Who had more influence in that case? The Moravians had more influence because they talked to people in their own language, so in, they talked in Estonian and other local languages. And a third division occurred between so-called church pietists, so those pietists who remained within the church, and those who were outlawed as radical pietists. And you know this better than I do. Church pietists did not shy away from vitriolic attacks against radicals involving moral as well as theological accusations. So these are bitter stories to see, and the question is, what does this mean? And the question arises here, is pietism really one coherent big movement, and one coherent big movement which belongs together in essential points, or should we not rather see it as a two or three different movements which were only put under one umbrella by church historians, most notably by the church historian Albrecht Ritschl in the late 1880s, who wrote the three-volume magisterial history of pietism, which for 100 years was obligatory reading for everybody who worked on pietism. And Ritschl not only included the radicals under this umbrella, but more importantly also the Moravians. Up until 1880, the Moravians had not been part of the story of pietism, but had been considered as a separate renewal, revival movement. Since Ritschl, also the Moravians are called Pietists first, Moravians second. And of course, by doing so, the criteria for a proper definition of Pietism have become rather vague. And this is something which plagues historians of Pietism up to the present day. This brings us back also to the question of typology, these conflicts which are there. And after reading your book, I wonder whether it would not be very helpful to speak of pietisms in plural and establish the radical pietism as a distinct group of their own, which is equal and perhaps no less worth than church pietism. Because much of pietism research has been supported by churches. And so there is this inclination to say the church pietisms were actually the better pietists because they believed in reform. while radical Pietism, they had a sort of an egoistic trait to their theology. Now, what characterizes these radical Pietists? They are ready to separate themselves from the official church if they consider this necessary for progress in their spiritual life. That's very important. They are willing to emigrate if they are persecuted. So they risk their lives and their future in search of a place of refuge, even in distant parts of the world. They are not ready to compromise. They have a strong belief in lay initiative. They don't need clergy. They trust their own reading of the Bible and their understanding of the Bible. It's the spiritual empowerment of lay people. And of course, then the millennial hopes. In short, their theology is overwhelmingly eschatological. And for many of them, as you mentioned and described very well, the established churches can no longer be saved. And true believers, the really true believers, have to find a way outside of the established churches. And also the radicals, carefully analyze what they call the signs of the times. These signs of the times can be strange phenomena on the sky or natural disasters like earthquakes or the moral deterioration in particular of the ruling elite and in also very important, the persecution of the faithful children of God is also a sign of the time. What do these signs mean? Why are these signs important? Because they show when salvation history, how salvation history progresses and how salvation history comes to an end and when Christ will return. Now, all these signs are proof that they live in the end time. And this is why they no longer need to make compromises, because their eternal salvation is at stake. In this context, it's important to note that political troubles, warfare, social disturbances, in short, hunger, disease, and war were not over with in Central Europe with the end of the 30 Years' War in 1648. Rather, these troubles continued, war continued, economic troubles continued, and also, especially, disease continued well into the early 18th century. And these were the times when sort of the radicals found proof for their worldview. In short, to sum up this point, one should perhaps reconsider that the radicals not only deserve recognition as a chapter in a history of Pietism, but rather they are a formative group of their own, which is just as important as those who believe that the church can be reformed, that there is still some hope left, that the church is not doomed. My fourth point is Pietism and Enlightenment. You explain very well that both of these movements paved the way, paved the path to modernity in Europe, and this is certainly correct. But I should like to underline more the obvious differences which existed between some of the Pietists. Now I lump them together again and speak of Pietists and enlightened people. Yes, both supported social progress, at least main groups in Northern Germany did talk about social progress and supported that. And this in Halle, for example, there was not much difference between enlightened philosophers like Thomasius and the position of someone like Franke. And yes, both strengthened the role of individual believers against clerical hierarchies. Yes, and the cultural impact of both of these groups is remarkable. But there are also significant differences. Now, Pietists never held the notion of unlimited innerworldly progress. Even if the Second Coming was postponed for some years and Philipp Jakob Spener, the patriarch of Pietism, spoke of the hope for better times, well, there is some hope for better times until Christ does return. But, he surely will come, and there is no open future like some philosophers of the Enlightenment would argue. Also, no less important, Pietists believed in the real presence of the devil in everybody's life, as in the world at large. The devil was a real force in also, which could capture whole persons, whole groups of persons also. And also, Pietists, in contrast to the scholarship of enlightened scholars, they, with very few exceptions, practiced a literal understanding of biblical texts. Not learning was important, but the right kind of belief and trust that God would guide you through his word, that God would help you to understand the text. And if you didn't understand it right away, prayer would help you, and then you would understand. So in the early years of Pietism, 1690, 1700, especially in a place like Halle, you would have some overlapping of Pietist and enlightened influences and aspirations. But as time went on, feelings of hostility grew stronger and stronger. Enlightened figures started to ridicule Pietists. There is enlightened theater on Pietists, in which Pietists appear as the fools. And also, especially after the French Revolution, absolutist governments, which were advised by enlightened counselors, they really persecuted Pietists without mercy, as people who sort of had not grasped the necessities of the modern world. And this is an argument, I think, which is important also with regard to the presence. If evangelicals today are critical of liberal policies, this is not something new. Rather, their arguments can be seen as a continuation almost of a two-century-old tradition. Now, my last point is the relationship of Pietism and other movements for religious renewal and religious awakening in the modern world. And the context is, of course, how does religion react? How does religion change in the context of social and cultural modernization? How does modernization affect pious people? You mentioned Reginald Ward. Following Reginald Ward, you described very well that Pietism was part of a larger movement for religious renewal and religious awakening in Europe and beyond. And this is something which is very important and which has to be recognized. And German Pietism, therefore, has to be seen and understood in close relationship to Puritanism and also later to Methodism and Quietism and the Quakers, the First and the Second Great Awakening, the Réveil in the French-speaking parts, and also the various forms of evangelicalism. And there are even some parallels within Catholicism, like Jansenism, which one should not forget. But what we need, and this is the point where discussion is important and where the exchange between those working in the field is very important, what we need are more precise descriptions, not only hints about similarities, but attempts to see how these movements did in fact interact. And you gave a lecture in Halle half a year ago, a little bit more, last year in August, which was very important in that respect because you talked about translations. And you showed how much was translated by Pietists from authors of these other religious movements and also from Catholic sources. So Pietists, they use the other movements. And of course, one should continue this work on translation and see how much of the original Pietist texts were translated into the texts used by other religious movements. For example, Pietist hymns, which hymns were included into hymn books, American movements of the first and then of the second great awakening. When did this enter? And I think if one was would look for that, one would could find a great deal. So the interactions are yet something which we have a feeling that they did occur, but we do not have quite the proof in all cases how this happened and how it was very precisely. These are, of course, general studies about religion in the process of modernization, and more precisely about the role of fervent believers as they experience political, social, and cultural change, and also about the degree to which they themselves contributed to the transformations in the modern world. Now, let me add, modernization is more than the Industrial Revolution, although the Industrial Revolution changed the lives of millions of people. Modernization is also migration, including immigration and the emigration of religious people. It's mass communication, it's secular education, but also religious education. It's progress in the fields of medicine and health, political repression and political participation. So it's a wide open field. And how do we fit Pietism into this wider and open field? And now let me make some rather speculative remarks, but we should attempt to connect a figure like Spener with Karl Barth, Zinzendorf and Martin Luther King, Gottfried Arnold with Dietrich Bonhoeffer, August Hermann Franke with Desmond Tutu. And only by doing so, I think, will our students begin to grasp the breathtaking importance of Pietism in the early modern era. These were daring people. These were people who had visions, who risked their lives to have a, and they believed in a mission. But only if we point into the direction that these, that there are these overarching considerations, I think, we will do the right kind of job as scholars and as teachers. Now, in conclusion, your book is a major contribution to our understanding of Pietism, and Pietism researchers from around the world have every reason to be grateful to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Hartmut. I should say that this is just the latest inning in our exchanges over the years. I've been in conferences where Hartmut Lehmann has been the chairperson. I've given a paper, or he has responded to my papers. We've had numerous exchanges over the years. So this is just the latest edition of our exchanges. And I hold him in the highest regard. And I'm especially grateful that he could be here today, tonight. I want to respond to three things. I won't respond to all five, but I think I'll maybe respond to three of the points that you made. I'm glad that some of my students are here. I think this is somewhat educational in how scholarship works. I mean, right, it's an ongoing enterprise. It is communal. There's an exchange. And just when you think you've made a great point, somebody says, well, on the other hand, you know, there's always that other hand, darn it all. But no, that's just a fact of life. That's the way scholarship works. And I do believe that scholarship is a communal enterprise, and it's exchanges such as we're having tonight. I hope there'll be a second edition. And if there is a second edition, I will take into account some of the things that Hartmut Lehmann has mentioned this evening. And so what about Württemberg Pietism? When I had completed this book, I knew right away that I'm in all honesty here, before I even knew that we'd have this exchange, I thought, you know, Hartmut Lehmann is going to want me to have said more about Württemberg Pietism. I was well aware of that. Professor Lehmann's second thesis, his second doctorate, as you're required to have in Germany, was on Württemberg Pietism. And one of the points he makes is that we shouldn't restrict its chronology to the 17th and 18th centuries. So I know the argument well. And so it might be too strong to say I felt guilty, but I just felt, you know, there is a criticism to be made, and you did not disappoint me. You made it. But in all honesty, I think if I do have a chance to provide a second edition, I will make the point that there is this Southern German Württemberg Pietism that deserves a larger place. It does have a place in my book. It has a place in my discussion of a radical Pietist named Rock, who is from this area, and of course in my discussion of Bengel, who's from this area. So it's not as if I ignored Württemberg entirely. But your point is well taken, that I think it's fair to say that even today, the most conservative university theologically in all of Germany is in Tübingen, which has this Pietist heritage. One of my colleagues at Trinity Western went to Tübingen because he felt more at home there. He had a THM from Dallas Theological Seminary. He wanted to study in Germany. He went to Tübingen, and that was a good choice, I would think, if you wanted to be in a more conservative atmosphere. So I take your point in terms of the importance of Württemberg Pietism, and certainly more could be said. We do talk about reformations, plural, today in Reformation scholarship. Should we talk about Pietisms in Pietism scholarship? And of course, in the back of my head, I hear Hans Schneider saying that we should not make too radical a division between, he's a professor in Marburg, between radical and church Pietism. And I think, as you've expressed yourself, it's a little bit too sharp a division, because there was a back and forth. There were figures that were radical Pietists and became church Pietists. There were church Pietists who became radical Pietists. In other words, some felt at home in the state Lutheran Church or the state Reformed Church. My first book on Pietism was on a court preacher. So here he is. He is the chaplain to a prince. And yet you look at his writing, and it's quite unorthodox. On that basis, you could call him a radical. And yet he is a church Pietist. His salary is paid for by a prince. So it gets complicated. And so I'm not ready to make as hard and fast a division between these two groups. I think there are lots of commonalities that join radicals and church Pietists. At the same time, I think my book makes clear, I agree with the idea that the radicals are an equal part of the story. There is this tradition of Lutheran church historians who think that Spener and Franke are the real Pietists. And then you get these women that I talked about, and then you get these radicals, and they're a kind of a falling away from true Pietism. And I do reject that in my book. A case has been made that radical Pietism was really the original Pietism. At least in Frankfurt, there are parallel streams. They begin together. Schutz and Frank and Spener together were the founders of Lutheran Pietism, and Schutz was a radical, and Spener remained a Lutheran all his life. So I agree with your point that that the radicals are central to this movement. And then your point about Pietism and Enlightenment. There are other things I could comment on too. I think one part, there is an aspect of my book, in the back of my mind are North Americans. And so I think I'm writing about Pietism for a North American audience in many ways. I'm trying to introduce German scholarship, but in some ways the agenda in the back of my mind is for North Americans. And another part of my agenda is an aspect to this story that is new. And a new aspect of this story is scholarship that says that Enlightenment and religion are not opposites. In the last 10 years, there's been a new scholarship in the Enlightenment that says that, I mean, the French Revolution is obviously kind of an instance of religion against Enlightenment. But the new scholarship is saying that doesn't set the agenda. That is not the whole story. And in the British Isles, in Germany, the Enlightenment movement began among clergy. So the Enlightenment is not anti-religion. The Enlightenment is within Christianity. It is changing Christianity. It's not against Christianity. And so I'm quite excited by this scholarship. And so without denying that there are discontinuities, I think of the fellow who came to Göttingen.
His father was a professor in Cambridge, and he wrote this book. I'm mixing that up. Anyway, there was a fellow I met in Göttingen, and he did a book on Timasius and Timasius' religion. So here is the founder of the German Enlightenment, Christian Timasius, and this fellow in Göttingen was writing a book just to make the point that this founder of Enlightenment in Germany was not anti-religion, was not anti-Lutheran, was not anti-Christian. So I was kind of excited by that new scholarship, and that certainly reflected in what I had to say.
Let me just make two brief points. You're also looking at the watch, and the audience should be included. What the last thing that you said, of course, I noticed scholarship also, but it's a different type of Christianity that they cherish. And the longer, the more you go into the 18th century, and the more you, after two or three generations, those enlightened Christians and Wolf and others, of course, they are church members, and Christianity is very important for their ethical studies. The more they think that the Pietists are somehow backward, they have lost the touch. And so there is an element of discrimination and looking down. And actually, the culmination of that is around 1800, especially in those territories which are under Napoleonic rule in Germany. There, the prisons are filled with Pietists because they refuse to accept new liturgies. They refuse to accept new enlightened hymn books. And there are some villages in southern Germany where they send military, send soldiers so that a new hymn book can be introduced. These kinds of quarrels are important to have at the back of your mind. And the other point, when we talk about radicals and church pietists, what really worries me and actually is, aggrieves me a great deal is the lack of brotherly and sisterly love of church pietists when it comes to censoring the radicals. They don't see that the radicals have something to contribute.
Much less the state Lutherans, the Orthodox Lutherans.
You can't forget about them.
But even so-called fellow pietists.
Even fellow pietists, there's a lack of brotherly love, or sisterly love, you know. And this is, so they don't see that what is lost in their churches if these people are forced to emigrate. This is a real loss for religious life in Germany with long-lasting consequences.
What would those consequences be, just very briefly?
Well, the empowerment of lay people, that the lay people are sort of, well, there is Reformation teaching which gives power to the lay people in the church. That is more and more lost, and you have an educated clergy which sees themselves as scholars of theology, looking down on those dumb people to whom they have to preach every Sunday, but rather they would do something else.
The Pietists would have been a corrective to that.
Absolutely. And these lay people come to North America. Of course, it's good for Pennsylvania and beyond, certainly. But if you talk about secularization in Germany and want to understand when secularization begins and what it means, it means also a loss of highly religious people, devout people, fervent believers, people who are no longer there. And masses of religious people continue to emigrate all through the 18th century. And the same occurs again in the 19th century. So religious people do leave, and it's not only, I mean, our research on migration has for too long been seen only, has only for too long only seen economic arguments. People leave because they want to have a better life. No, they are leaving because they want to exercise their religion freely and without a dictate from above.
Okay.
Maybe we should pass around the mic, if you don't mind.
Okay, I have two questions. I just need a little bit of a clarification between Pietism and piety. What's the difference? And the other question is, I'm a fan of Martin Luther, so I've been to Wittenberg and so on, and Eisenach recently.
Come to tomorrow's lecture.
And he had been an Augustinian monk in the monastery in Wittenberg, and his wife, Katharina von Bora, had been a nun in a convent, and then he helped the nuns escape, and he fell in love, married her, had six kids, and raised four more of their relatives, so raised 10 kids. So the next question is, when Mr. Bissell founded in some village somewhere in Pennsylvania a monastery for men and a monastery for women, did any of them fall in love and get married and have 10 kids?
Okay, good question. I mean, one of the points I think that we've been trying to make is that Pietism is a dramatic turn away from traditional Lutheranism. However you define Pietism, there's something new going on. And certainly Luther turned away from the monastery. How interesting that Pietists return to the monastery. That, I think, confirms there's something else, there's something different than Luther going on here. So your point is, your observation is a good one. I don't know that there was a lot of hanky-panky going on in Ephrata, to be quite honest. I left out a thing I was going to read among the Labadists, who were very influential on the Pietists, and they were committed to celibacy, and then one of the sisters got pregnant. And they said, uh-oh, what do we do now? And then they decided to reinstitute marriage among the Labadists when it appeared that there were problems with the issue of celibacy. I haven't heard of that among the Ephrata community in the same way.
Just a brief remark about your first question. Now, piety is a disposition. You are pious, and then one can say that you demonstrate piety. But pietism is a movement, a renewal movement, and also in religious sociological terms, introducing new forms, namely the conventicle, as a meeting of people during the week, in the evening, groups of 10, 12, or 15. Conventicles can be larger or smaller. Not only the sermon on Sunday morning gives you the truth, but they discuss these matters in conventicles. And also there's a growing body of literature which is considered important. So if you are a pietist, you read these books. And there's a growing body of these books which are important. If you read the books, you become a member of the movement.
Question. Oh, thank you. I actually had two, but I guess I'll follow up on the first question and really just push that point a bit further. And that is to ask what the theological grounds among the Pietists was for monasticism, for celibacy, and asceticism. I can think of social reasons following the collapse of the church state with the 30 Years' War, and the desire then, or the sense then that the entry of the church into political life was a bad idea, but then Tomasius had the same view and wanted to make a separation the other way. So what were their theological grounds then for moving away from the integration of religious life into secular life?
I can give a very simple answer. It's their concern that their souls would be lost. So it's the attempt to save one's soul in an age of turbulence, in an age of insecurity. And so to save one's soul, it's almost like an existential concern. That is important for them. They know very well that our time on this earth is very short, and you have to see that mortality was high, and everybody was confronted with people dying right and left, and at 8, at 12, at 15, at 25, you know, in all ages, age groups. And you had to be prepared when death would be, it would be your hour of death, you would have to be returned, to be prepared to stand before Christ at the last judgment. And this is a very deep felt existential fear.
I would add two more words. Why would a group like the Erfurter Cloister practice such ascetic denial? It's very un-Lutheran. I would say two things, conversion and perfectionism. The Pietists, in many, many cases, had a before and after story. And so they had consciously turned away from the world, away from the church in which they were raised, or at least the form of Christianity in which they were raised, and are seeking new birth and then seeking to live a new life. And so the bar is set very high for these Pietists. And that's because of what they're reading. They're reading, ironically, they're reading some medieval books, such as The Imitation of Christ. But they're also reading Johann Arndt, who says that Christianity is all about recreating the image of God that has been lost and should be restored. So there's a new optimism among the Pietists that you do not find in Luther. We can actually do this. We can live like Christ. We are born again. All right, so the bar is set very high for these people to live a dramatically different life than the comfortable people around them who think they're Christians but really aren't. Does that help?
Yeah. Thanks for an unbelievably interesting evening and for a book that Doug really sounds like it's not just valuable but it's also well written. And that's nice, something you can give to students to read and they'll get it.
Which I've done.
Yeah. I'm thinking first year students, which is what I teach, so they could read this and get it. I have a question. There's so many questions that come to mind, but I'm really interested in this question about pietisms, but maybe more specifically around the idea of the formation of identities that pietism contributes to. Often the 19th century is seen as sort of the birth of national identities and so on, and we can certainly tie pietism in the 19th century to those, but it seems to me that your book might speak to the way in which identities, both regional and what will eventually become national identities, are being shaped by pietism. And maybe if you could speak a bit to that sort of pre-19th century impact that it has.
Actually, my next project is personal identity in pietism and enlightenment. But my focus isn't exactly what you've described so much as national identity as a sense of agency and individualism, which I think is coming through in the memoirs and the diaries and the autobiographies. So there are thousands of these. There's an archive in Herrenhut, Germany, near the border with Czech Republic. And it's estimated that archive has 30 to 40,000 Moravian memoirs, unpublished memoirs, because it was part of their religious identity, at least by the time they died, to write about their story, their conversion story. So I'm interested in these kinds of writings, but there are more formal autobiographies that were written as well, and memoirs. And so I'm convinced that there is a sense of individualism, which we all have here today. Peter Berger's described it so well. He calls it the heretical imperative. To live in the modern age, in a real sense, we're self-made. We decide what education we'll get, what vocation we'll follow, and what church we'll go to. And we feel complete freedom to do all those things. Well, that freedom is a modern phenomenon. That individualism is a modern phenomenon, and I'm convinced that it really begins in the age that my book is describing, Pietism and Enlightenment. So I'm not so much looking at this from the national perspective you've described as a much more reflection of a culture of individualism that is arising and a new sense of empowerment and freedom and agency that is coming about in this age. And some are suggesting that before the Enlightenment promotes this, it is actually religious groups that are promoting this first. Enlightenment gets on the bandwagon of this individualism. It doesn't create it. It's not as if Pietism is responding to Enlightenment. A case can be made, it's Enlightenment that's responding to Pietism. That the individualism begins there in religion.
You ask a very interesting and controversial question, namely the chosenness topic. Is it transformed from the individual to the communal level onto the national level? This is something which is open for debate. I mean, there are scholars who argue that and others who dispute that. But it is something, there is something there. And it has especially been well, not documented, but argued for the case of Prussia, that some of the Prussian values come out of the Halle heritage. I'm very skeptical about that because there was no militarism or militaristic tradition in Halle, and bureaucracy was rather chaotic. So, but on the other hand, of course, many of the Halle alumni did work in the Prussian church, in the Prussian as chaplains in the Prussian military, and so on and so forth. Though there is a contribution and there is an impact. But how far and in which way is controversial. And when it comes to 19th century Germany, the same story can be made again. There are Pietists which consider the victory over France in 1871 as a gift by God, that now Germany is the chosen people, and it fits very well into their theological mindset. But on the other hand, those who brought about the unification of 1871 certainly had other things in their mind.
I think we have time for one more question.
I have two more questions. Is that, or maybe a question and a comment. I want to pick up that strain just very briefly that was going before the most recent question. You know, why did the Pietists do what they did? Whether they're radical Pietists or more churchly Pietists, why did they do what they did? And the answer that they were dead serious about their eternal salvation. They wanted to be ready. They wanted to do it right by God. Could you also make a statement that in spite of the fact that the Orthodox of that period did a lot of bad things, nevertheless, at heart, among the best of those Orthodox, that there were people who were concerned with exactly the same thing, but yet they were going about it in a different way, in a doctrinal way, not an experiential or a way that related to doing. Which I think you could argue, going back to Luther, that this is a valid way of approaching one's Christianity based on Scripture. So sometimes I think we can kind of, you know, dismiss the Orthodox, but the very best, I think, did it right. And so this is not a question, maybe just a comment. If you'd like to say anything, I'd be really interested in what you'd have to say to that. And then I have just a real quick question after that.
Well, you'll be happy to know that the end of chapter one of my book makes precisely that point. In fact, a case can be made that it was an Orthodox influence that gave rise, in some measure, to Pietism. And you're right, the Orthodox not only got the Bible right in many ways, but there was social and practical and devotional renewal among the Orthodox as well. So there are scholars who suggest that Pietism actually grew out of Orthodoxy. And so you're right. In fact, another case has been made recently that there has been almost too much attention devoted to Pietism as opposed to the Orthodox, that there's a lack of scholarship on what is happening in Lutheranism, a state form of Lutheranism during this time, and I think that's right. A good friend of mine, Anselm Steiger in Hamburg, has devoted his career to doing a better job of giving a fair portrayal of the Orthodox. They are not all dead, they are not all anti-piety, you know, all those caricatures fail
and that is one change in the scholarship today. The setting for Pietism is not dead orthodoxy. The first devotional books that Spener used in Frankfurt at the beginnings of Pietism were books by Orthodox writers. So your point is an excellent point.
So your final question, very briefly.
Very briefly, I have read your book, and thank you for reminding me about what you, I remember now what you said in chapter one. I've worked as an editor for the last 20 years, and this is kind of just an editorial, personal question. Why did you end the book with the negative side, the dark side of piety, or pietism, I mean? That's a just a kind of a more or less an interest question for me.
I want you to know that I did not end it that way lightly or thoughtlessly. I actually had written another introduction that avoided the negativism completely. And I showed it to somebody and they liked the shorter introduction better that left out the negative. But then a friend of mine that I admire very much, not in this case Hartmut Lehmann, but Jonathan Strom, I showed him the chapter that included the negative. He said, you've got to do this. And I decided to go with Jonathan's advice. I think the reason is that so much of what is being written about pietism by North American scholars is just glowing. And it's this old idea that the pietists got it right and the Orthodox Lutherans got it wrong. And I just felt that a contribution I could make was to say, this is not a fair picture, it's not true, and it's not balanced. And so the negative that you get there is simply, and I think that is, you'll note that I do mention two scholars in particular with whom I interact. I just felt that, in fact, I came out of a conference on pietism in St. Paul, Minnesota, in which I felt constrained to make this point. There is a dark side to pietism. Nobody else was saying this. These pietists are wonderful, and the problem with the church today is we're not like those early pietists. Well, if we're like those early pietists, we'd be messed up. It's just like saying the early church was perfect. It wasn't perfect either. So I just felt I had to make that corrective, and I think I made the right decision. You're right, I end on a very negative note. But in the context, it's a note that I thought needed to be sounded.
Well, Professor Shantz and Professor Lehmann, thank you very much. Please join me in thanking them.
Thank you, Paul.